Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we are going to record the second part of this series of videos where I'm explaining how to deploy applications in Google Cloud. And today we will deploy the application to the virtual machine. We will create a Docker, a container. This means as well that we will install Docker on the VM, and then we will finally serve the application and do some testing to verify that the application is running correctly. So we are going to use Streamlit to serve the application, the library, Dockers, and the VM that we created in the part number one of this series. You have it available on the channel. If you had any problems to find it, let me know on the channel and I will point you out where is this this video. So we connect to the VM that we previously created with SSH. I already explained how to do this in the part one. So I'm connected to here, and now we will install a environment manager like Conda, Anaconda. This is up to you. I already have installed it. I had Anaconda, but you can install whatever you please. I will patch you all these commands in the description of the video, and also I will put them in the repository just to you keep you have all of them available and you can follow and complete them in your local environment. For the time being, I will step out up to the installation of the Git, because I will put you this in the description of the video. If you execute Anaconda, I have it already here, so you can install Anaconda, Mamba, Miniconda, Virtual Environment. Environment, this is exactly the same. It's just a environment manager at your preference. You can install whatever you want. It's not relevant for what we are doing here. I used to install Anaconda because I remember very well the commands how to do it. No? Well, then on, I recommend you to install some utilities like GIT, because we are going to clone the repository, Nano to edit in local if you want to edit some files, and curls if you don't have installed it. I already have it. And then on first time that you interact with a repository, especially if you are going to clone or push something from GitHub, you can check if your Git is installed. You have it there. You will need to set up the global, the user email. Here, just change the email address for the one that you want to use, and also set up the username. Okay. Then on, I have created a folder with some repositories. I will remove the previous one. I already record the video in Spanish. I want to remove this RF test. -minus. Okay, so I will create it again. Oops, ls, and we will clone the repository again. I don't want to override what I had already there, and then here it supports that it will be. To clone the repository, you just need to go to your repo. Let me 1 second, I will find it. Okay, I'm going to install my application. It's a private repository in this case. I will free up later on the app once I finish all this stuff. But well, you just copy the URL and you can come here. git clone Gemini bot. Yeah, you need to provide a username. As is private, in my case, for example, tag one, and a token. If you never create a token, let me show you how to do it. Here, let's go. You can go to your account, you go to settings, you go to developer settings, personal access tokens, go to token classes, you can go fine-grained tokens, but it's still on beta, so I prefer to do it on the old style. Generate new token. You just hit a note just to understand what is a minimum or at least you need these permissions to push, clone, whatever the token. Most of the other is for other services available in GitHub, so it's up to you how you want, which permissions you want to get. I told you expiration date as well. If you don't write anything, you can write here no expiration, but well, it's, I used to write 180 days, and after that the token is gone, just in case it's a security issue. You generate the token, write them down, because never ever will appear again. So if you lose this value, you will have to generate a new one. I'm not gonna use it, so I will use the one I have created for this. You just paste, and here we are. You have the repository, and you can see here what I had. So the same that you had in GitHub. Now I will show you. I will go to my prod where I had the final. I make a small change in the Docker file in the previous video, so it's not the final one what I had there. And so you use Nano Docker file, and I explain you exactly what we had here. So we had our image. We will use Python 3.11, the slint, so the minimum one. We use an argument, an arc directed. This means that we are going to receive via argument when we do the build of the Docker a parameter, and then we will receive the value of this parameter in the user underscore app variable. Then on we assign the value of the argument, the user app, to the variable user underscore app with the directed env. You will be you probably wonder why R and M. Arc are variables that works only during building, when you are building the Docker. So the context of this variable is inside the building. So you can apply it anytime here, but this variable disappear after the Docker is built. Environment, in the other hand, works at building time and also at execution time. So this means that this variable, when we run the Docker, after building, we will have a variable inside the Docker with the name user underscore app. And then you can if you are going to, you plan to use this variable inside your Docker execution, the only way to do it is that way. And the only way to pass parameters from the command line that affect to the creation of the building or the building of the Docker is using that way, with arguments. Okay, so I will show you later when we build the Docker how it works. Now we run the update and upgrade of the Docker. The Docker that is coming with the 3.11 is an Ubuntu 20 2.0.4, si no, if I don't remember well, I install some operating system libraries and upgrade the Python version. Here I'm creating a group with the user app variable, and I add a user. I create the home directory, and I provide and I assign the ownership of the home directory to the group and user that in this case have the same name. I also put on the path the home directory of the recently created user. I set that as a working directory for this application inside the Docker. The directory slash Gemini is an application which is using the Gemini model. I copy the file requirements txt into the working directory, and I also run here the I'm installing the via PIP the requirements txt file. Then on I provide or I grant ownership of the home directory to the user. To the user I will pass via parameter or argument to the Docker, and also to the group user, which is exactly the same. Actually, it's the same that we created here. Okay. Finally, we create some permissions. Probably it's too much. Probably you can reduce it. Well, it's just a test. I will add that this later on. I will explain you what I'm doing that. And also expose the port, which the application is using to serve the information of the application. In this case, Streamlit is using the port 8501 by default, and this application is going to run under the user that you will send via arguments when you build the Docker. Why I'm doing that? Because it's a security good practice not to run the Dockers with the root. If you don't specify user, the application is going to run with root permissions. And well, you can do it, but under a security point of view, it's not optimal and you shouldn't do it. And finally, the entry point, which is running Streamlit and running the page.py, that is my first page, the first page of my application, and in the port 8501. Once you have your Docker created, you just. Ah, sorry, I forgot that we need to install Docker before. To run Docker, Docker is not coming by default. I will pass you as well all the necessary instructions in the description of this video. You first of all remove case that does exist some of these files. Then you download the GCP the GP no GPG key of Docker. To your operating system, you later add the repository to the apt sources, similar to this, and you just install finally the components: Docker CI, Docker CI, CLI, container.io, and plugins, and together as well with the Docker Compose. I already have it. You can test it later with Docker. Yeah. The Docker is installed with under root permission, so when you want to build an image, you will need to run escalate with sudo to be able to do something with your Docker. Here, Docker PS is just listing the images that you have running already. You can see that I have my application running in the server. So now, if you want to build the Docker, you go to the root where you have the Docker file, In this case is here, we are in the directory, and then on you just run docker build with some parameters. So what we are doing here, docker build, hyper pull, this means that we will download from Docker Hub the Python 3.11 slim, the image that we had on the front, hyper rn is deleting any image that is running on or in memory. This in this case, if we run it, it will remove this image. Hyper build hyper arc. You can see here the mapping. So I'm assigning to the variable. This, remember that this is the variable that I have on the directive arg inside the Docker file equal app. This means that the user I will create during building and the user I will use to run the application is going to be app. This is also creating the user. And the home directory, etc. The group is going to be app. Hyperf is the Docker file. Hyperd is the Docker name and semicolon the tag of the image that you are building right now. And here the dot is the scope. Scopes mean that everything that is under, in this case, that is we are using the dot. This means everything under this folder, repos app Gemini bot, will be copied to your Docker container. You just execute it. We can do it. There is no problem to do it. Yeah, it's pretty fast. As well, you know that Docker is had the intelligence, if you can say that, that it nothing changed. Since the last time that you build the Docker is like Git, it's not doing anything. We didn't change the Docker file, not the requirements. So the layers, that every layer you see, they are taking the layers from the cache. So it's not building anything. In any case, you are starting from scratch. You will see it's going to take a while. Up to you have your Docker created. Now, to run the Docker, I had two requirements in my application. I need to persist the content of the carpet of the folders, answers and prompts. So, this you probably know when you run a Docker. Everything that you change during execution, you will lose it. That's why I need to persist whatever is done during the execution in something, in some folders in my local environment. So what I did is create two folders in my home, in the home of the host, answers and prompts. And now when I run the Docker, I will show you now the command. I just mounting. So here what we are doing is Docker hyper p. We are exposing or connecting the local post 8501 to the Docker port 8501. Hyper v. We are mapping my home holonaut underscore gmail underscore con slash prompts slash table to the folder inside the Docker home app gemini prompts table and the folder with another folder home holonaut underscore gmail blah, 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 answers to the folder home app gemini answers. Now which I will run the gemini that bot semicolon latest. This is the latest the latest build that you made with the tag latest, and that's all. And here I write the ampersand just to execute it on the background. When you do that, you will see that you later execute sudo docker ps, and you can see the image that you have running. If you execute Docker, sudo Docker, sudo Docker images, you can see which images you had in your system. There is no, there are previous versions. You can delete these orphan images. You can delete it to save some space. If you want to stop the application, you just execute Docker PS, and then you can do sudo Docker stop and copy paste the container ID. With this, you will stop your application. And if you want to enter into your Docker with a bash, for example, sudo docker exit hyper IT, this is interactively, you take the container ID and you execute a bash. This is not stopping the execution of the Docker, you just enter in with an interactive shell. You can see here is app, is the user that we use to create the Docker. Here, app, we are in the home directory, home app Gemini. You remember in the Docker file we use as a working did, home app Gemini. And now we are going to go to answers. Here I have the answers I got from my interactions with the model. We are going to write a file, and you will see how this works. Okay, now we have this file, processes.txt, and we leave the Docker. And if we go to answers you will see the file here, processes. So this is already in my operating system, in my machine, not in the Docker. And then you can do a cat processes, and regardless, if you now shut down the Docker, let's do it. Docker PS, sudo Docker stop is stopping, but you can check here processes is still there. You can do a cat. And now we are going to start the Docker again with the command I showed you before. This is the way that you had if you want to persist some information. Now you have it here. Now we can go to our application. I think is, let me check where I had. Okay, I have it here. And you have your application. This is the IP address where it's listening. And essentially, let's check if this is working. Where I have this, let's take a file. I will explain you in the next video what I'm doing here. I'm using Gemini to extract information from PDFs and images, and with some tailored prompts, I extract the relevant information from each type of document. So this is working. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, let me just test. We send the prompt to Gemini. We are sending the prompt together with the file, and Gemini will answer something. Here, when I write finish, it's writing here, resetting the, and you can check here in the answers we have a new one. Now it's 1827, So is that one? No, 18. Yeah, here you have the processes. It's even the file. And this is 1727. I need to check 1720. Ah, that one. Yeah, it's 1 hour. Yeah, exactly. So now we can go to the again to the to our repo answers, and you will see here our new file is for now. Let me check the time. Oh, date, sorry. It's exactly, it's 1 hour. 1 hour before UK. I don't know why. I need to check that, but okay, that's really doesn't matter. Okay, so we have already the application running, and the last thing I wanted to show you is the firewall. Because if you don't open the firewall, never ever is gonna work. When you create a project in Google Cloud, it's creating a VPC, a virtual private cloud by default. And if you don't specify anything, when you create a VM, a virtual machine, it will fall into that VPC. So let's recap. We had our computer engine as a VM instance. We created in the part number one of this tutorial. Then on once you created, I went to VPC network IP addresses, and then I switched the IP address from ephemeral to static. You can do that just clicking here, promote to static IP address. So now the internal wall is ephemeral. I don't care because this is only for internal communications. And the static one is always gonna be the 3489.95.169. It's static. This I already did. Once you have this done, you need to go to the firewall. Okay. So check in your VM before. Sorry. So check in your VM. If you go to the VM itself, you need to check which network you see is your in which network, in which VPC, network and subnetwork. Usually when you are working in a company and there is a big deployment, usually there is multiple VPCs. A VPC is a concept of network, and you place the servers, the VMs, the services in different VPCs. This is a common security good practice to segment and to apply different security measures to the different services, depending on if they had exposition to internet or not, or depending the criticality of the data that they are hosting. In this case, we just had one server that is not really important. We need to expose the service to internet, but in complex scenarios where you had multiple services, multiple users in different regions which access to different services, and not all had to access to all services, we used to place the VMs in different networks. You need to set up the non-firewall rules in between the services and routing in between these services. It's exactly the same that we did in the past when everything was running in data centers and on-premises. And today we do the same when the servers are running on the cloud. And the policy and the rules applies exactly the same, and it's a good practice to do it like that. No? So we are in the network default, so we can go directly for here, and you see here this is the VPC, Virtual Private Cloud. You go to the firewall and you add a firewall rule. to open the port 5801. You can go here to the rules, and you see here I already had one. You can just simply add a firewall rule, and when you add it, I will edit it here to order to see. The first time that you set up the rule, activate the login in order to keep track of who is accessing, or if you had some accessing problem, whatever. I advise you to do it, activate the log. So you are in the network default. This is a key to understand where you are placing the firewall rule. The priority in this case is not very important. This is only in the case that you have multiple rules that apply to the same server or to the same network, and then the priority applies. But in this case, we only have a server, and we are going to introduce only one rule. The other ones are default rules for management, which you don't need to care about. No? So the targets in this case is all instances in the network, but you can specify also tags. When you create the VN, you can apply a tag just to identify the VN in Google, and also you can apply targets like service account. So everything that is running on this under a specific service account is the target in that case. In our case, is all instances in the network, because we only had one VN on that network. Source filter, in this case we are going to allow everything which has a correct IP version 4 address. Why we are doing this? Because everybody from internet can connect to this port. Secondly, here we should activate the address, the destination address. In this case as well, there is only one server, so it doesn't really make much difference. But in other scenarios where you had multiple servers, you need to apply the destination filter. Destination filter is the public IP address of this machine. The public, you can also specify the internal IP address, but again, if you don't have a static IP address, it's a nonsense, because the rule will never apply. So usually the destination filters apply to the public IP address, which at the same time used to be static. And then on the ports, in this case we just open TCP 8501, and you can also set up the UDP version in case that you are using UDP. And also you have other more complex protocols like IPsec or something like that. You can also specify other. Just imagine that your server is doing a VPN with another server in another cloud, or in another VPC. You need to specify, for example, other protocols like LAC or IPsec or whatever you are using. This is when it's not a protocol, a TCP or UDP conventional protocol. Usually when there is working at level 5, level 6 of the TCP/IP protocol. Well, you can save what you have, and this again, this is critical, because it's not for more than you investigate, you will never ever access to the application. And I think that's all. I think that's all. In the next video, we will take a look to the application itself. We will look at the Streamlit. I use this library to build the application. And we will look as well how I make the connection with Vertex AI in Google, and using the Gemini Pro model, and well, a little bit the workflow of how I'm building this interactive bob, which uses files and prompts to provide answers to an specialist in this case. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you like it and you find it interesting and useful for your job or your training. and it is like this, well, give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with your friends and colleagues just to help me to promote the channel in YouTube. Thank you very much. See you soon.